Je m'appelle Maud Doucet. Pour ce projet, je suis curatrice associée à la recherche. Donc, dans cette exposition, on s'est appuyé sur deux objets d'études principaux. Le premier objet d'étude, c'est l'école de Casablanca, où on a essayé, pareil, de déconstruire un petit peu le processus de cette école et de réfléchir dans les différentes formes qu'elle a pu créer. Donc, on a notamment réfléchi à la forme éditoriale, Maghreb Art, qu'on voit ici. En fait, on a repris différentes planches de la revue. Et l'idée, en fait, c'était de montrer comment est-ce que cette revue a pu être un support pédagogique pour l'école et également servir de moyen de diffusion dans l'espace public. C'était important pour nous d'arriver dans cette exposition à recueillir des témoignages et à recueillir des sources primaires qui manquent et qui nuisent en fait aujourd'hui à la recherche en histoire de l'art en 2018 dans notre époque contemporaine. Sur cette table, on a voulu mettre en avant différentes, encore une fois, supports éditoriaux qui étaient importants à cette époque-là pour véhiculer différents discours sur l'art qu'on voulait novateur et expérimental. Et notamment, un des projets qui a été supporté dans ces différentes plateformes éditoriales, c'est aussi le travail des intégrations qui a été pensé par le cabinet Farahoui et Demazia. Et c'est un projet considérable qui s'étale sur 15 ans, dont on voit en fait ici dans l'exposition certains supports, et qui a en fait contribué de manière souterraine et pas toujours assumée, ou en tout cas pas toujours supportée par l'État, de produire un certain nombre d'œuvres dans l'espace public, spécialement conçues pour l'architecture et pour le lieu. Donc il y a différentes structures qui ont été concernées, qui sont principalement des structures publiques, comme des postes, des hôpitaux, des écoles, des banques, etc., etc. Et puis aussi, il y a un travail important qui a été fait autour de l'hôtellerie, autour des hôtels dans les années 60. Et ça contribue aussi, ou en tout cas ça illustre aussi, une période assez interventionniste de la part de l'État qui va mettre pas mal d'argent pour financer ou en tout cas pour développer un tourisme de masse dans le sud du Maroc.
My name is Maria von Osten. I'm a curator and artist director of Bauhaus Imaginista, together with Grant Watson, who is from London. I'm from Berlin. And I did, together with Maud Hussais, for several years research in Morocco, where we are investigating about artists that had been active in a movement after 10 years after the independence of Morocco and developed a radical aesthetic. And due to this research, it was possible to find out that there was a link to the Bauhaus. And in 2016, I was starting to develop a project. It's a long-term project, which celebrating 100 years of the Bauhaus. And it will have an exhibition in Berlin in 2019, because the Bauhaus was opened in 1919. But it also will have a lot of stations, and this is the first station. So this exhibition is the opening of a whole series of events. It's a Bauhaus and Imaginista. And Imaginista is for sure Latin language, but it's also a little bit like Esperanto, Bauhaus Imaginista. So it's imaginative potential of the Bauhaus that we are interested. And one has to think that the Bauhaus in 1919 had to open up after the First World War, and it was absolutely disastrous situation in Germany, and it was a young generation that was absolutely fed up with the parents or the patriarchal structures and what happened to this kind of disaster. And Gropius' manifesto in 1919 is actually kind of a conjuncture of very different thinking, and where he actually wants to have a new curriculum and think that there has to be also an aesthetic revolution, which also needs new education. And this is very interesting, because this we find as well in Morocco 10 years after independence, where also a new society has to be invented after colonialism, and there was a lot of thinking from this generation about how colonialism has worked, not only in terms of occupation and exploitation of soil and labor force and domination of people, but also on the psyche and on the culture. So they were actually interested in decolonizing culture in terms of that they were working against the categorizations that came from the European science and also from the colonial science. And then they invented a new curriculum, and this is kind of an interesting material that we see here on the wall. There's on the one hand the art populaire, and there's Tony Marraini, one of the art historians working in the Ecole de Casablanca, as well as a part of her curriculum, which is La Moderne, where she actually focuses on the Bauhaus, as well as here a mural workshop in Nasila. I mean, this is all a little bit different times, but it's kind of a good collage to say, I mean, what they intended. On the one hand, they actually took up the idea of the Bauhaus, of creating in workshops. You know, the Bauhaus did not have an academic study program, but it was actually apprenticeships what people did. Mm-hmm. So they were learning by doing, really in workshops, also learning crafts, and then using the abilities of craft and handicraft to develop something new for a new society. And this was similar in the school in Casablanca, where they were actually learning from Berber crafts and the urban Arabian or urban Andalusian crafts in the interior and the exterior. And this is also important because the Bauhaus manifesto says, you know, the arts should be integrated in the building again. So the building would be something like a space where all the arts would be integrated, which was, as this artist in the post-independence area found, the whole tradition in Morocco, which was still alive. So it was the everyday life culture where actually it was that the arts were integrated in the building. But the French had actually named it naive art, or the l'art indigène. So they had really a kind of a racist connotation towards and created a minor vocabulary, one could say. So for them it was also to free it from that vocabulary, and then they were calling it art populaire. And I think it's important because art populaire does mean it is contemporary. It's not tradition, it's not the past, it's actually our lived environment. It is that what is connected to the people. And for Tony, who was an Italian art historian living here in Morocco, and she was also for a while married to Mohamed Millet, who was one of the central artists, she brought in for sure ideas of Western modernism in radical avant-gardism. But it was not only her, it was also that Melehi had studied in the United States and learned in the Columbia University how photography was introduced by sociologists. So he came back and he was actually running the photography class. So that does mean that they also came in the 1960s here in Morocco with a curriculum that was much more advanced than similar time in the academies in Europe. Because in Europe, I think, photography was introduced in the 1990s, and so 30 years later. You know, so it's very, very interesting how advanced they were and how much they both, when we were modern, we did the conversations with people that were involved in changing the curriculum, how much they were aware also about Gropius' legacy and the potential. And this is also why Bauhaus Imaginista is such a good title, because it still asks us today what kind of art institutions we need for the practice that we are doing. And if we are imagining a new society, it might be that we also have to rethink our institutions.